Hey everybody, it's Jay Winters here for University Lutheran, and today is a big day. We're breaking out of the Old Testament and into the New Testament, which means that we're hearing stories now officially about this guy. We're hearing about Jesus' birth and childhood today, so let's jump into it. So, Jesus' birth and childhood, we're going to have a couple of different things here. Basically, we're going to break them up into three different categories. So, first category is before the birth of Jesus, so the things that happen before he's actually born, then his birth and infancy, and then his childhood. So, that's what we're going to be taking a look at throughout the course of what we're going over. So, let's jump into it. First, we've got before the birth of Jesus. So, there's three stories here. There's a message for Zechariah, who is sort of Jesus's cousin's father. And then the birth of Jesus is announced. And then after that, you have the birth of Jesus's cousin, John the Baptizer. And so things don't just start with Jesus's birth. They start just a little bit earlier. And that's what we're going to take a look at here. So, first thing, message for Zechariah. Zechariah is a priest. He goes into the temple to present a sacrifice to God. And while he's in there, he sees an angel. And this angel gives him good news. The angel tells him that he and his wife are going to have a child despite their old age. Sort of reminds you of hints of Abraham there. Zechariah doesn't immediately believe it, sort of like Sarah didn't immediately believe it when God told her that she was going to have a son. And so the angel makes him not able to speak anymore until the child is born. And we'll get into that later once John the Baptist is born and we talk about his story. So then after that, we get a sort of interlude, and then we go to the birth of Jesus being announced. You'll notice that most of these stories come from either Luke 2 or Matthew 1. So Luke 1 and Luke 2 and then Matthew 1, those are the different things that kind of talk about Jesus' childhood. We don't have a lot of information about Jesus' childhood, but we do get some. And so here we've got the birth of Jesus being announced. He's announced to two different people. First, he's announced to his mother, Mary. The angel visits her and says that she is going to be pregnant. And then later on, after it becomes clear that she's pregnant and Joseph doesn't understand why she's pregnant if he wasn't the father, he plans on divorcing her very quietly. But the angel visits him and tells him not to do that. So then after that, we get the birth of John the Baptizer. John the Baptizer is the son of Zechariah. He is the precursor to Christ. He's the person who is preparing the way for Jesus. And so the words of the angel come true. This son is born to Zechariah and Elizabeth. And then when Zechariah uses the name John instead of Zechariah, which would have been normal, he would have normally been sort of like Zechariah Jr. But he goes completely sort of left turn and says, hey, his name is going to be John. That shows that he's taken the message to heart, and then he prophesies about what God is going to do through John. So, after that, we are going to get into the actual birth and infancy of Jesus. We're going to look at those things. Those pretty much all come from Luke 2, so that's what we're going to be taking a look at. So, these stories are the stories of Christmas. They're super familiar stories. You probably feel like you recognize them, and yet they've got something to them, something interesting. So, first we're going to jump into the birth of Jesus. So, Joseph and Mary travel to Bethlehem, to the city where David is born, in order to participate in a census. Joseph is registered in Bethlehem because he is a son, a descendant of David, the big king that we talked about just a few weeks ago. While there, Mary goes into labor and gives birth to Jesus while she's there. So he is born in the same town that David is born in. Then after that, we get after his birth, then the angels announce that he is born. And so they go out into the countryside, and the first people to hear about the good news are not kings, they're not officials, they're not religious figures, but rather they're just simple shepherds. And so God shows that his son is not only going to serve the high and the mighty, but instead he's going to also be serving the low and the humble. After that, we get Jesus presented in the temple. This is a really amazing story as Joseph and Mary present Jesus in the temple. They're supposed to do that because of Old Testament law. And so they go to the temple, they offer two pigeons or turtle doves, and these are the sacrifices that are stipulated if you don't have a lot of money. If they did have a lot of money, they would have been sacrificing a lamb. However, the law made for an allowance. If you didn't have a lot of money, then you could sacrifice two pigeons or turtle doves. This shows us something about who Joseph and Mary were. They weren't people particularly of a lot of riches and things like that as they were presenting Jesus in the temple. While he's there, he meets Simeon and Anna. Simeon, while Jesus is there, Simeon takes the baby Jesus into his arms and he sings him a song. And that song ends up being a part of our church service. It's called the Nunc Dimittis. It goes, "Lord, now you let your servant depart in peace." That song. And so that comes from this part of the story. So then we're going to move on from the birth and infancy to Jesus's childhood. Childhood of Jesus compared to the rest of his life, we don't know much about Jesus's childhood. We only know a little bit, and we know a few little things. So first of all, we're going to get the Magi from the East. So the Magi, or the wise men from the East, they come from the East. They're probably from Syria. They see a star in the sky, which they correctly interpret as a sign that God is doing something amazing in the world, namely that he is sending his son Jesus into the world. The Magi come and they worship, and Herod sort of tries to get them to tell him where Jesus is. Herod is the king of Israel at the time, and he's a little bit jealous of this new king. And the Magi say, "Okay, we're gonna go visit him, but let's not go back and tell that guy because he was kind of scary." And sure enough, he's going to be super scary. We'll see that in a little bit here. Another thing to keep in mind is that when the Magi visit Jesus, it's likely that Jesus was up to 2 years old, because we'll see a little bit later that when Herod sends out soldiers in order to do something terrible, that his order is for all of the children that are two or under. So this happens later, even though most of the pictures that we have of the Magi visiting Jesus, a lot of times those show up and Jesus is pictured as a baby. He should probably be more of a toddler. All right, so next we get the escape to Egypt. So, like I was saying, Herod gets concerned about the possibility of another king in Israel. He's the king of Israel, and he's pretty nervous about that. He knows that he probably shouldn't even be the king of Israel. And so he orders the murder of all of the children of Israel, 2 years old and younger. Jesus and his family escape because an angel comes to Joseph and tells him to leave. And so they escape Herod's death squads, and they go and they live in Egypt for some time. We're not sure exactly how long. Then finally, we get Jesus at the temple. So, Jesus returns from Egypt. He goes on on about his 12th birthday. He was 12 years old. The Bible tells us that he goes to Jerusalem in order to visit the temple around the time of Passover. While he's there, his parents lose track of him, and they're like, "Uh-oh, what happened to Jesus?" Finally, they find Jesus where he feels like he should have been, in the temple, talking to the rabbis. And all of the rabbis in the temple are like, "Wow, this kid is really a whiz at the scripture stuff." Which makes sense. If Jesus is the Son of God, he probably gets this stuff really well. And so, he says that I should be in my father's house, meaning God, his father, not Joseph. And so, there we kind of get a little bit of sense that Jesus actually knows who he is, that he is the Son of God, and he's here sent for a purpose. And we'll start seeing that purpose unfold when we start to look at the rest of his life and the beginning of his ministry in the next series. So thanks a lot for being with us, and have a great rest of your day. We continue on with the next 100 Bible stories in a little bit.